Hi, everybody. So welcome to this afternoon's seminar. It's a real pleasure to welcome Donita Brady to speak to us. So Donita did her PhD at UNC Chapel Hill with Adrienne Cox, working on rho GTPases and epithelial morphogenesis, and then moved to the counter lab at Duke for her postdoc, where she made a really interesting discovery about the role of copper in oncogenic BRAF signaling. And I guess this opened up an important new area of research sitting at the intersection of kinase signaling, metal biology and cancer, which Donita's then pursued in her own group at University of Pennsylvania. She's going to speak to us today about the secret life of copper. So welcome, Donita, and I'll hand over to you.
Thank you so much, Joe, for the invitation to speak with all of you today and for that really kind introduction. It's a pleasure to share some of our work with you on the interplay between copper homeostasis, kinase signal transduction, and how we try to leverage those connections in the context of cancer. And so this all goes back to intracellular signaling networks and the fact that normal physiology really does rely on the orchestration of complex processes within cells, between cells, and among cells in their environment in order to maintain proper tissue homeostasis. And to enable this precise coordination of these cellular processes with both dynamic spatial and temporal control, evolutionarily conserved signal transduction pathways depicted here serve as a means to integrate and distribute information within cells. And the proteins within these signaling pathways function as nodes to both respond to and sense inputs and in turn regulate outputs that are important for cell biology. And during that multi-step process of tumor initiation and progression, cancer cells require unique capabilities termed the hallmark of cancer that are depicted at the bottom of my screen. And thus, it's unsurprising that aberrant activation of signaling initiators, shown here in green, or inactivation in signaling repressor shown in red, disrupts the tight control that signal transduction pathways typically have on cellular processes that, when dysregulated, drive these hallmarks of cancer. And decades of research has really revealed the complexity of oncogenic cellular signaling networks and their exceptional vulnerability as targets in cancer. And so my lab now focuses on protein kinases and their role as oncogenic drivers that can be effectively targeted as cancer vulnerabilities. And protein phosphorylation regulated by these protein kinases is the most common form of reversible post-translational modification, with an estimated 50% of the human proteome undergoing phosphorylation. And the state of any one of those proteins can be phosphorylated is then regulated by the coordinated action of specific protein kinases or protein phosphatases that add and remove that phosphate group respectively. And so while there are about 518 kinases and 156 phosphatases in the human genome, not all of them contribute to cancer. And so in a recent pan-cancer analysis, looking at copper number alteration mutations and expression changes or chromosomal translations, 91 protein kinases are known to be cancer drivers out of the 1,000 identified alterations in the genome of these cancers. And so this can happen through mutations, for example, in EGFR, or gene amplification in the context of HER2, chromosomal translocations in the context of BCR-ABL, which drives CML, and actually identified here at the University of Pennsylvania, and that's why it's called a chromosome. But out of the 91 oncogenic driver proteins, not all of them have small molecule inhibitors that can target their aberrant activity. And even if you have small molecule inhibitors, and we've seen clinical efficacy for many of them, several challenges still exist, such as the emergence of resistance, tumor cell heterogeneity that limits response, and undruggable target. And so we still need to identify other ways to target protein kinases as cancer vulnerabilities. And one of the best illustrations of that is in the context of metastatic melanoma. And so, as many of you and Joe alluded to in the introduction, a group in 2002 searching for mutation in the components of the canonical MAP kinase pathway, so the RAS-RAF-MEK-ERK signaling pathway, and a large panel of common cancers revealed that 60% of melanoma actually carry an activating mutant in the gene encoding the serine-threonine kinase, BRAF. And a follow-up to that breakthrough study actually identifies that these BRAF V600E mutations actually present in the precancerous nevi then go on to drive melanoma and initiation. And so many pharmaceutical companies went after specific, mutant-specific small molecule inhibitors. And showing you here is one of the initial responses to the BRAF inhibitor, the vemurafenib, in this 38-year-old patient who had BRAF mutant metastatic melanoma deposits on the chest. This patient was given the vemurafenib for about 15 weeks. And in B, you can see that there's almost complete resolution of those lesions. However, 8 weeks later, this patient represented with lesions in many of the same sites that had gone away. And this was actually due to reactivation of this canonical MAP kinase pathway due to upregulation of receptor tyrosine kinases, point mutations in other MAP3 kinases, or activation of the MAP2 kinases themselves. And thus the real shortcoming of most current kinase inhibitors, this is this development of resistance, and really lies the need to identify new modes to new modes of regulation of kinase regulation. And so since the activity of protein kinases, as I alluded to at the beginning, can be regulated by multiple inputs such as nutrients, each of those inputs be thought of as a therapeutic vulnerability. And MIND is really interested in this interplay between oncogenic kinase signaling and nutrient homeostasis to leverage those interactions in the context of cancer. And so we think about this in terms of cellular metabolism in some contexts. And once thought of merely as the byproducts of cellular metabolism, we now really do appreciate that metabolite cells can directly regulate cellular processes by functioning as signaling molecules. And thus the availability of any given metabolite function to promote regulatory post-translational modifications on proteins or affect protein structure function via direct metabolite protein interactions. However, unlike these organic metabolites that can be synthesized and degraded via enzyme reactions, metals are quite unique in that they can neither be created nor destroyed in biological systems. And therefore, proper dietary and constrict homeostatic mechanisms to regulate metal abundance are really critical to organismal survival. And so my lab is really kind of interested in this kind of emerging paradigm by which either metabolites or micronutrients, specifically metal, can actually participate in signaling events through direct interactions with proteins and in turn regulate cellular processes. And so for the rest of my talk, I'm going to focus on metals and specifically the transition metal copper. So I'd like to give you a little bit of an introduction to how metals function in biological systems. And so they can really be thought of in two different categories. The first being dynamic signals or static cofactors or redox inactive or redox active. And so in the case of the redox inactive earth metals, such as sodium, potassium, magnesium, and calcium, and divalent zinc. These are thought to be regulated by large changes in concentration availability that can regulate signaling events inside cells. So we're all used to thinking about how calcium levels can be changed inside cells, and that can relate biology. In contrast to that, the redox active transition metal, such as copper and iron, owing to their potential to trigger fitting chemistry when unregulated, have been studied largely as static cofactors that are typically buried within enzyme active sites and help contribute to either structural or catalytic functions of those proteins. And today what I'm gonna describe for you is this an atypical regulation of a protein kinase via allosteric regulation of its kinase activity via the transition metal copper, where we think that the redox potential of the metal helps to activate protein kinase activity. And so how do we get there? We've much of what we know about copper's importance in biology is really driven by what has been known about two rare genetic disorders, specifically Meckes disease and Wilson's disease. And outside the cell, copper is found in its oxidized copper two state. It's then reduced by the steep family of metalloreductases, where it's imported through the homotrimeric copper transporter, CTR1. And then once inside cells, copper is immediately bound by low molecular weight glutathione or copper chaperone proteins that are important for delivering copper to copper-dependent enzymes localized in multiple areas of the cell. For example, the copper chaperone CCL delivers copper to the superoxide dismutase, which is important for getting rid of oxide and converting that to molecular oxygen or hydrogen and hydrogen peroxide. In contrast, the yet-to-be-identified copper ligand, shown here as copper F, is important for delivering copper to the mitochondria, where it's required for the most evolutionary observed copper-dependent enzyme, cytochrome C oxidase, where copper binds in both the copper A and copper B sites. And then finally, ATOX1 takes copper to the P-type ATPases, ATP-A, and ATP-7B, depending upon the tissue. And this leads to the import of copper into the secretory pathway. Many of the secreted copper-dependent enzymes like dopa-beta hydroxylase, lysyl oxidase, are actually copper-bound and then secreted from cells where they impart their function in circulation. And so we know so much about the handling of copper based off of these rare genetic disorders, first being Meckes disease, which is copper deficiency. And many patients with Meckes disease typically exhibit stunted growth and failure to thrive like phenotypes. And this can be modeled in the molted brindle animal, where you see animals are much smaller in size, and they're actually hypopigmented. And this is due to the inactivation of the copper-dependent enzyme tyrosinase. And then the other is Wilson disease, where you have mutations in the P-type ATPase ATP7B. And in this case, the liver hyperaccumulates copper, and this can lead to neoplastic proliferation and steatosis in the liver. And in the context of not being treated, you can sometimes get abdominal malignancies, especially in the animal model of Wilson disease. And so this really suggests that there's this interplay between copper and these growth-like phenotypes, but a molecular mechanism by which copper contributed to these two growth-like phenotypes was not well understood. And so that was one of the questions that we aimed to address when I was a postdoctoral fellow at Duke University. And my collaborator, Michelle Tursky, made the interesting observation that if you stably express oncogenic RAS in the Drosophila eye, you typically get this rough eye phenotype due to the overgrowth of cells and the fusing of omatidii. But if you simultaneously express RNAi against the copper transporter CTR1, you can completely obliterate this rough eye phenotype. And so this was the first kind of suggestion that there was a genetic connection between proper copper transport through CTR1 and a RAS-driven phenotype. And because this phenotype was known to be dependent upon canonical MAP kinase pathway activation, we next asked whether or not there was a step in the MAP kinase pathway that was less active in the absence of the copper transporter CTR1. And so here we took mouse embryonic fibroblasts that were either wild type or knockout for CTR1, and then simulated the canonical MAP kinase pathway with the receptor tyrosine kinase ligand FGF. And so in the wild type cells, you can see robust activation of the pathway within 5 minutes. However, in the CTR1 knockouts, you see lower basal activation pathway and lower stimulated activation of the pathway. And interestingly, the only difference in the canonical kinase pathway in these CTR1 knockouts was the ability of MEK to phosphorylate ERK. And so this suggested to us that potentially the MAP2 kinases may be coppering proteins themselves. And so we next tested and found that the copper could bind to MEK1, and then in a series of in vitro kinase assays, see copper stimulated activation of the MAP kinase pathway that could be inhibited with the copper chelotetraethyl molybdate. And so this all went on to show that there was this interesting connection between the canonical MAP kinase pathway and copy of this direct interaction between copper and MEK1 and MEK2. And so as a pharmacologist, I was interested in trying to identify a way that we could utilize this information. And so copper chelators that are utilized for the treatment of disease might be one way to forestall MAP pathway activation in both naive and MAP inhibitor resistant forms of BRAF mutant melanoma. And so to prove that, we just first take the mouse embryonic fibroblasts that were either wild type or knockout for CTR1, and we stably expressed oncogenic BRAF, and we injected those cells into immunocompromised mice, found that the CTR1 knockout cells formed much smaller tumors, and they took much longer to grow. So the latency was about 2 to 4 weeks longer than the CTR1 wild type. We also related this to a genetically engineered mouse model of melanoma, in which there is a pre-activatable BRAF allele and the loss of the tumor suppressor P10. And then we enrolled mice into different treatment cohorts. And the take home here is that when we started to treat mice from the time that they had a pigmented lesion to a tumor of a certain size, what we found is that we could extend the time it took to get to 1 cm³ tumor if we treat the copper chelator, tetraethylmolybdate, shown here in red. And we very similar delay in tumor kinetics with the copper chelator that we got with the vimorafenib. But if we combine the two together, we could extend this even further. And then finally, in the context of MAP kinase inhibitor resistant melanoma, here we do this by adding a activated variant of MEK1 and then looking at tumor growth over time. And so one, we knew that we could model resistance to vimorafenib where the tumors actually grow a little bit better in the context of the BRAF inhibitor. But we could still reduce tumor growth over time with the copper chelator. And so this really does suggest that together copper chelators and MAP kinase inhibitors could be part of a rationally designed clinical trial to in the context of either naive or MAP inhibitor resistant forms of BRAF mutant disease. And so when I started my lab at the University of Pennsylvania, we knew that there was this interesting interplay between copper homeostasis and MAP kinase signaling, and that we could leverage that connection in the context of BRAF mutant melanoma. We had many questions that were left outstanding. And one of those was whether or not there were other targets of copper inside cells and whether or not there were other signaling pathways that were that could respond to changes in copper availability. And so in order to kind of frame that these questions, what we started to do is ask whether we can map copper utilization by kinesic signal transduction pathways as a new strategy in the therapy. And so we thought about this by first trying to ask, could we define what the copper binding kinome looks like? So what are the targets of copper inside cells? Could we identify oncogenic pathways and processes that were affected by copper availability? And by understanding what those pathways and processes were, in turn, identify answers that may be depend upon copper availability. And so what I'd like to share for you for my talk is our new work on copulation of the protein kinases L1-2 that are important for autophagy and how we've loved that in the context of KRAS and BRAF mutants of lung cancers. So one of the things we wanted to do is determine whether or not there were other copper-dependent kinases. And so our approach to this was first asking whether or not other protein kinases actually required copper for their kinase activity. And so we did this by screening 414 kinases that are available in the Invitrogen Flex Screen kinase profiling service. We incubated each one of those kinases with a high concentration of the copper chelator TTN, and then asked which of those protein kinases could be inhibited to a similar degree of MEK1 and MEK2. What we found is that of the 414, there were 132 hits. So while this is a fairly large number of amount of the kinome that seems to be require copper for activity, we wanted to be able to funnel down from 414 to a reasonable amount that we could ask or not those protein kinases actually bind to copper itself. And so what we did here is we utilized a kinome open reading frame Larry developed at the Broad Institute. We then stably expressed the entire kinome and 2-3 T cells. And from the 98 of those protein kinases were represented in the library. And we were able to ask which of those 98 actually bind to a copper charge ring. And so what we were able to narrow down in is there were 66 copper other protein kinases that either could be inhibited by a copulator and could bind to this copper charge column. And two that were of interest of Tiffany Zhang and Jessica Massimo in my lab were ULK1 and 2. And they were interested in these protein kinases for several reasons. One, that their kinase activity could be inhibited by 96 to 93% with this high concentration of the copper chelator TTM. And these protein kinases actually share sequence homology to MEK1 and 2 of the previous copper binding residues that we had previously identified utilizing screens against copper binding residues that are specific to methionine or histidine, and by using metal catalyzed oxidation followed by mass spec based approaches for MEK1. And so what you can see here at the top of the screen is that ULK1 and ULK2 share sequence homology in the copper binding residues that we had identified within MEK1. So one of the first questions that we asked is whether an ULK1 and ULK2 were copper binding proteins. And so here we purified recombinant ULK1 from bacteria and then looked at its ability to be pulled out by this copper, iron, or zinc charged resin. And so we found is that ULK1 could solubly bind to copper charged resin. And in a theory feature of kinase assays, if we looked at one's ability to phosphorylate one of its targets, G13, we could see in a dose-dependent manner, there was an increase in the phosphorylation of ATE13 when we added increasing concentration of copper chloride. However, if we added increasing concentrations of the copper chelator, we could see reduced kinase activity for ULK1. And this is similar to what you can see with the MRT68921 ULK1 inhibitor developed by Ian Ganley's lab. And so this suggested to us that ULK1 and 2 are indeed copper-binding kinases that require copper for their kinase activity. And so what do these protein kinases do? ULK1 and 2 are well-established downstream targets of the protein kinase mammalian target of rapamycin or mTOR when it is in the TORC1 complex. And so specifically when mTOR is in this TORC1 complex, it can control cellular energetics by driving anabolic processes such as lipid, nucleotide, and protein synthesis, and suppressing catabolic processes like autophagy. And so when nutrients are plentiful, mTOR and the TORC1 complex localized on the lysosome surface actually phosphorylates and inhibits ULK1 and ULK2 kinase activity. However, when there is an imbalance in nutrient availability, whether that be glucose, ATP, or amino acids, you get reduced mTOR kinase activity. This then relieves the inhibitory phosphorylation that mTOR typically puts on ULK1 and 2 and initiates the formation of an autophagosome, which can then degrade and recycle proteins, lipids, and organelles to restore nutrient balance in the form of building blocks for metabolic pathways. And specifically, this activated variant of ULK1 can translocate to the ER with its constitutive binding partners and substrates HG3-200 to drive SAGA4 formation by softening core components of the class 3 PI kinase or VPS34 complex. This is really important for generating 3P from phosphatidyl and inositol, whereby five domain containing proteins like LIPI1 or DFCP1 combine to the 3P and then lead to the recruitment of lignin-like conjugation complex ATG5 and 16 that are important for actually lipidating LP3B on its growing autophagosome. And so that's why we often use that as a readout for autophagy induction. And once this autophagosome is formed, it then fuses with the lysosome, and that's what allows for the recycling of nutrients. And so one of the first questions that Jessica and Tiffany asked is whether or not altering copper availability would affect autophagy induction. And so to do this, we took CTR1 knockout cells. We re-expressed the human transporter or NMC vector and then characterized how much copper was available in these cells by using the CF4 copper probe from Chris Chang's lab at the University of California, Berkeley. Specifically, copper binds to the sulfhydryl within this copper probe. And so it's an on-off probe, meaning that when copper is abound, you get a signal. When copper is not bound, you don't get a signal. And so these cells seem to be about 50% deficient in their copper availability. And so we then asked, what happens if we induce autophagy in these cells by withdrawing amino acids and then clamping or preventing lysosome acidification with vancomycin so we could see how many or quantify the amount of LC3B2 that formed. And so what you can appreciate is that when we withdrew amino acids and then did a vancomycin clamp and the wild type cells, plenty amounts of LC3B2, well, that is reduced in the CTR1 deficient cells. Then importantly, are 50% reduced in their copper content. And so that suggested that copper was required for autophagy induction. So we next asked whether or not it was sufficient to increase autophagy. And we did this by creating a stable knockout of the copper exporter ATP7A. And so here, when we knocked out ATP7A in mouse embryonic fibroblasts, we found that there was an increase in LC3B2 level, suggesting that copper is indeed sufficient for increasing autophagy levels. And this is in line with some more recent work from Roman Polishak's lab at the Technion Institute, where they looked at autophagy activation in Wilson disease hepatocytes. And so here, these hepatocytes have loss of ATP7B function. And what they observed is in the ATP7B knockout cells that they saw increased LC3B2 positive puncta. That you could, and you could observe in even more of these if you did a vancomycin clamp. In this case, this increased autophagy is important for getting rid of damaged mitochondria, and which is important for allowing these hepatocytes to survive the excess copper that is there. And so it's a pro-survival mechanism in Wilson disease that is in line with our results. And so since our findings really suggested that copper was required for alpha-1-dependent signaling and autophagic flux in response to mTOR inhibition, we next hypothesized that copper levels may fluctuate in an acute manner after autophagy induction. And so to this, we took our mastomeric fibroblasts and injected them to either plentiful amounts of amino acids, or we drew the amount of amino acids and looked at copper levels over time, utilizing that CF4 group road. And so here, this is just the control where there's full amounts of amino acids. And we're taking an image every 5 minutes, about an hour. And we don't see very much change in the fluctuation of copper availability inside these cells. However, if we withdrew amino acids and then looked at copper availability, we see that over time, there's an increase at this perinuclear locations where we think it's actually being released from the lysosome or mitochondria. And so when we graphy this, we see that there's a significant increase in copper levels over time when we withdraw amino acids. And so this really does suggest that there is a requirement for copper for efficient autophagic flux that likely correlates to helping support ALK1 and 2 kinase activity as the autosome forms. So to test that idea, we next looked at ALK1 activity in cells that autophagy had been induced in. And so here in the CTR1 knockout cells that are re-expressing the human transporter, we immunoprecipitated ALK1 and then looked at phosphorylation of the downstream target, ATG13. And so as expected, based on the release of that auto-inhibition, that mTOR typically puts on ALK1 and 2, we see increased phosphorylation of ATG13 when we take away amino acids. However, if the copper transporter CTR1 is not there, we see reduced phosphorylation of ATG13, which really suggests that the copper transporter is required for ALK1 kinase activity, especially in the context of amino acid withdrawal. But we knew that copper could impact multiple different pathways, specifically that it also could regulate MAP kinase pathway activation. And there are plenty of reports out there that the MAP kinase pathway, it's also critically important for regulating autophagy. And so we next wanted to ask whether or not this copper dependency for autophagy induction was happening either in a MAP kinase independent or dependent fashion. And so first we tested what happens if you treat CTR1 wild type or knockout cells with the MEK1-2 inhibitor trametinib. And what we found is that in contrast to vehicle-treated cells, treatment with the MEK1-2 inhibitor trametinib actually leads to an increase in LC3-2 levels. And this is in agreement with some data that I'll talk about in a few minutes from Channing Durr and Martin McMahon's lab, where they've showed that inhibition of the canonical MAP kinase pathway actually leads to protective autophagy induction through regulation of LKB1. Second, we asked what happens if we reactivate the canonical MAP kinase pathway in a copper independent fashion by re-expressing an ERK2 gain of function mutant. So here in the CTR1 knockout, we see reduced phosphorylation of ERK1 and 2. We can restore that with this ERK2 gain of function, but we're not able to restore autophagy levels. And so what tells us is that the copper requirement for autophagy actually is happening in a MAP kinase independent fashion. And to drive this home a little bit further, we also knocked out the endogenous ALK1 and 2 in cells and then looked at copper dependency. And what we found is that indeed loss of ALK1 and 2 reduced LC3-2 levels, but we don't see a concabinet or an exacerbated phenotype when we also get rid of CTR1, suggesting that copper is working via an ALK1-2 dependent mechanism. And so molecularly, ALK1 and 2 is critical are critical for autophagy induction. They play a role molecularly at a much higher upstream fashion, where they're really important for activation of this class 3 PI3 kinase complex, or specifically the V34 complex, and the deposition of PI3P ongoing autophagosome. And so one of the next things we want to do is ask whether or not we see differences in these molecular features of autophagy induction when CPR1 is knocked out. And so to do this, we created cell lines that were stably expressing a GFP tag 200 or ATG13. So first we're looking at whether an OLC1 complex can actually localize autophagosomes in a copper-dependent fashion. And so what we found is that in the CTR1 knockout cell, we see less localization of CYP200 to these growing agosomes. And similarly, when we look at the 5-domain containing protein with B1, we see reduced localization of WIPI1 to the agosome in comparison to our wild type cells. And so it suggests that copper is indeed functioning upstream of the class 3 PI3 kinase complex, where we see reduced amounts of recruitment of these proteins to the growing autophagosome. And to finally test whether or not there was an actual effect on autophagosome formation or number, we utilized a single GFP tagged LC3B construct, where we were able to look at autophagosome formation or number via flow cytometry. So what we do here is we either withdraw amino acids or treat with the mTOR inhibitor rapamycin. This leads to the recruitment of that GFP tagged LC3B to the growing autophagosome. We then treat those cells with saponin to get rid of any non-autophagosome localized LC3B. And then that allows us to quantify the number of autophagosomes that are LC3B positive inside these cells. And so when we withdrew amino acids or treated with rapamycin and did a bafflomycin clamp, we could see that there was an increase in GFP LC3 by flow cytometry, but that was reduced in the context of the copper transporter loss, suggesting that copper is necessary for autophagosome formation. In contrast to that, if we got rid of ATP7B and did the same exact procedure, see that there was an actual increase in GFP LC3 puncta or positive autophagosome number flow cytometry, suggesting that copper was actually sufficient to increase autophagosome number in these cells. And so all of those data point to the importance of copper transporter and specifically copper in the induction of autophagy via this ULK1 dependent mechanism. And so we next wanted to determine whether or not there was a cancer context in which we could leverage this information. And so we're in this, deciding about that by working by Eileen White and other groups, where they've shown that loss of ubiquitin-like proteins ATG7, ATG5, and either KRAS-driven lung tumors or pancreatic cancer actually requires autophagy. And so what Eileen White's group showed here is that loss of ATG7 can actually reduce the tumor burden of these KRAS mutant driven tumors, and that this could increase the survival of animals that had KRAS mutant disease. And so we next wanted to ask whether or not genetic ablation of CTR1 could actually alter KRAS driven tumor kinetics. And so to do this, we collaborated with my colleague David Felder here in the Department of Cancer Biology, who utilizes the LOX-OPLOX KRAS P53 FOXFOX model in order to genetically engineer mouse model to interrogate lung adenocarcinoma and specifically the function of tumor suppressors in that model. And so here we provided lentivirus expressing Cre recombinase Cas9 and a guide RNA of interest intratracheally to these animals to either get rid of target beta gal or TR1. And then looked at tumor growth over time by bioluminescence, because these mice also harbor outblox luciferase cassette driven by the ROSA 26 promoter. And so what we found is that the absent copper transporter CTR1 can lead to reduced tumor growth rates over time. And then if you eat these mice and look at a fixed time point, specifically 16 weeks, we see that there's about a 50% reduction in tumor volume, and that these lesions have less KI67 positive selection, suggesting that they're less proliferative. And so this means that DR1 is indeed required for KRAS-driven tumor or lung tumor formation. But we next wanted to ask what is the actual mechanism by copper may be important in these tumors. Importantly, it's likely multifactorial, where it's important for both MAP kinase and ULK1/2 kinase acting. But importantly, we know that the copper transporter, copper itself, is important for both MEK1 and 2 and ULK1 and 2. So it gives a little bit of an advantage over traditional MAP kinase inhibitors that instead have recently been shown to cause this paradoxical protective autophagy, which limits their actual efficacy in the context of KRAS mutant disease. And so when we looked in these lesions where we had knocked out the endogenous CTR1, we could observe reduced phosphorylation of ERK1 and 2 in these cells. And we could also observe a reduction in autophagosome number by electron microscopy. So both points of this pathway that are actually critical for KRAS to form tumors are actually can be targeted via copper reduction. And so to determine whether or not this is actually the survival of KRAS mutant cells actually depends on CTR1, we tested what happens in the absence of nutrients. So here we plate cells and grow them in very low nutrient context and then recover them. And the ability of cells to recover that that low nutrient context is dependent upon their ability to actually induce autophagy. And so if you knock out the endogenous ATG5 or CTR1, you see reduced survival of the cells, suggesting that their ability to survive nutrient scarcity is actually dependent upon the copper transporter, likely through autophagy, but we're testing that, seeing that now. We also asked what happens if you activate the canonical MAP kinase pathway, and unsurprisingly, you're not able to rescue this inability to survive nutrient scarcity if you reactivate the MAP kinase way, suggesting that copper is required for the survival in a MAP kinase independent fashion. So finally, we wanted to bring this back to the copper-dependent ULK1 kinase activity. So we wanted to test what happens if we hit the ability of ULK1 to bind to copper and look at autophagy induction. So first, we needed to create a copper binding mutant of ULK1. And so we mutated the conserved histidine and methionine and this methionine residue in ULK1 that had sequence similarity to MEK1 copper binding, the MEK1 copper binding interface. And by making that mutation, we were able to reduce the ability of ULK1 to actually bind to this copper charged resin. And this also leads to a reduction in ULK1 kinase activity. And so when we express this in our KRAS-driven lung cancer cell lines, specifically here, we knocked out the endogenous ULK1 and 2 and either re-expressed the wild type or a copper binding mutant. And what we found is that when we re-express the copper binding mutant, you see reduced autophagy levels, so specifically reduced ULK2 levels. And this correlates with a reduction in ATG13 phosphorylation. So copper binding to ULK1 is actually required for autophagy induction in the and signaling in the context of KRAS-driven lung tumor formation. And so to finally pinpoint whether or not ULK1 copper binding was actually important for KRAS-driven tumor growth, we took these KRAS mutant lung cancer cell lines and knocked out the endogenous ULK1 and 2 and either rescued with a wild type, vector only, or a copper binding mutant. Also utilized ATG5 as a positive control. As expected, knockdown of the ubiquitin-like conjugate machinery or ATG5 led to a reduction in tumor growth or. And if we re-express both in wild type cDNA, we were able to arrest tumor growth over time, suggesting that ULK1 and 2 are indeed required for KRAS-driven tumor genicity. But if we re-express the copper binding mutant of ULK1, we could still see reduced tumor growth over time. So this shows that ULK1 copper binding is actually critical KRAS mutant tumor growth. So in conclusion for what I've told you today, we discovered that copper binds to and is required for ULK1 to kinase activity by serving as a critical or new input for ULK1 dependent autophagy. In the context of cancer, we're targeting a MAP kinase signaling and ULK1 driven autophagy by limiting copper availability by getting rid of C1 and therefore kinase copper binding to ULK1 and MEK1 and 2 decrease oncogenic KRAS-driven tumor growth and survival. We're really excited about these findings, mainly because they really do chart new ground in nutrient signaling and cellular energetics and metabolic vulnerabilities in cancer and further establish that copper is a signaling molecule and can be a dependency in the context of oncogene-driven cancers. In the final few minutes, I'd like to show you some of our new data where we've tried to assess whether or not this would be a path forward in terms of utilizing copper chelators to solve autophagy in a BRAF mutant model of lung cancer. And so Eileen White's group has also shown that loss of ATG7 in the context of BRAF-driven lung tumors can lead to increased survival. So suggesting that autophagy is required for BRAF mutant tumors to survive. And we have previously published that knockout of CTR1 could increase survival at BRAF-driven lung tumors. And so Tiffany Zhang recently tested whether or not loss of CTR1 could impact autophagy flux and signaling in BRAF mutant tumors. And so what she showed here by going back to the model that we had previously characterized where we see that survival advantage, she found that knockout of CTR1 led to reduced LC3 positive staining in these BRAF mutant lung tumors, and that this actually also led to an increase in P62. So the cargo protein that is typically graded by autophagy when induced is stabilized in the CTR1 knockout cell. We take cell lines generated from these tumors and look at autophagy levels. We find that the CTR1 knockout cells have much less LC32, suggesting that there's lower autophagic flux and when you get rid of CTR1 and these BRAF mutant lesions. This correlates with a reduction in the phosphorylation of ATG13 or Beclin 1, which is another ULK1 target inside these cells. So here we are now establishing that CTRN loss can impact autophagy flux in this other mouse model. So what happens if you treat with a copper chelator? So we took one of our wild type BRAF mutant lung cancer cells and we treated with either trametinib, vemurafenib, or the copper chelator TTM. In this case, we can see reduced phosphorylation of ERK1 and 2 as expected. And we also observe a reduction in autophagy levels, while traditional MAP kinase pathway inhibitors actually increase LC3-2 levels. And this is actually what leads to their efficacy in the context of BRAF or KRAS-driven MERS. Similarly, when we look at a downstream phosphorylation of ATG13 or Beclin-1, we find that the treatment with the copper chelator reduces phosphorylation of Beclin-1 and ATG13, while treatment with the MAP kinase inhibitors actually increases Beclin-1 phosphorylation. So what happens to the survival of these cells? Interestingly, if you knock out CTR1 or ATG5, the ability of these cells to survive nutrient scarcity is reduced, as expected, similarly to what we observed in the KRAS mutant lung cancer model. However, if you treat with the traditional MAP kinase inhibitors and subject these cells to nutrient scarcity, they actually still survive, which is very different than what we see when we treat with the copper chelator, where those cells are not able to survive nutrient starvation. And we think that this is because you get dual targeting of both the MAP kinase pathway and ULK1 and 2 kinase activity. And so in some ways, utilization of copper chelation can be more beneficial than traditional MAP kinase inhibitor treatment, at least in this context. And so finally, what we're really starting to do is really expand the contribution of copper as a signaling molecule in biological systems, where beyond it being important for energy maintenance and metabolism and synthesis of biocompounds, we've identified multiple ways in which copper can actually function as a signaling molecule, either through regulation of protein kinases or regulation of other enzymes like specifically phosphodiesterases that are important for regulating cyclic AMP levels, or where histones actually bind to copper and function as reductases. And so we really are expanding what copper can do and how to think about its utilization. So with that, I thank the members of my lab throughout the talk. And we've had multiple collaborators here in the US and across the world. They've been really impactful in our ability to do this work. And these are our funding sources. And with that, I'd be happy to take any questions you might have.